Hello, I'm Doug Muzio. This is the first in a two-part city talk on the New York State and New York City budgets, the policies, the priorities, the politics. He's in charge of more than $130 billion in state pension funds. He created a firestorm over Wall Street bonuses and executive pay. He's the bearer of bad news, huge budget gaps, high unemployment, more jobs gone in 2010, and more budget game playing by the legislature and the governor. He says it's time for New York to get transformative, or else. He's Thomas DiNapoli, the controller of the state of New York. He's here to talk state budget, city budget, Wall Street, Main Street, recession, job loss, and Albany insanity. Before being named controller in February 2007, Mr. DiNapoli had served in the assembly for 20 years, representing the 16th Assembly District in northwestern Nassau County. Welcome back, Mr. Controller.
Doug, it's been too long. I'm glad to be back.
The last time was February in 2009, and things have gotten weirder and worse.
Yeah, yeah.
What's going on in Albany? It's not funny anymore.
No, not even remotely.
It's
serious business, and it's the people's business, and there's a lot that has to be done, which is why, certainly from a fiscal point of view, it needs to be a transformative year. And I think many would argue, beyond just the budget, it needs to be a transformative year. The good news is, by the way, in November, every office is up for election, so there's the opportunity for the people to make it transformative. In the meantime, we've got to get through this process of making tough budget decisions in the face of this ongoing recession.
Yeah, but how real are these tough decisions in a dysfunctional, in fact, non-functional government? Are you at all sanguine that those folks up there, the 62 of them in the upper house, the 150 in the lower, and the governor can get together on this?
Well, there's really no alternative. They have to. You know, the budget has to get done. Decisions have to be made. The governor's not running again, but many of the others, most of the others in the legislative offices are. People are going to evaluate them based on the results of that process. So that should be a pretty strong incentive for doing things in a different way and a better way. And the problem is not self-correcting. You know, when we got into this recession, you know, people weren't sure of the time frame, how long would it be. This budget that we're just concluded the fiscal year with, I criticized at the beginning, but it was based on a premise that the economy was going to rebound very quickly. That didn't happen. It's still not happening. So some of those tough choices on spending that have been deferred for a long time, you know, the day of reckoning really is here now.
Yeah, but I mean, you released on this past Monday a report called New York's Deficit Shuffle, April 2010. And the press release is headlined, "Stop Playing Games with the State Deficit." And you charge in the first paragraph that New York State has missed budget deficits and growth spending for more than a decade by shuffling money between accounts, offloading operational spending, and on and on and on and on. Yeah. This is a major systemic mess.
Exactly right. And really the point is that we've run out of time to play those kinds of games. And this is why it's been very hard for people to understand the magnitude of the problem, is that by using these kind of gimmicks and these kind of budget techniques, it really masks the reality of the problem that we have. So when you have a cash shortfall, instead of, at the beginning of the process, putting an honest budget together that uses real numbers, you have a cash flow, so you go into one of the special revenue accounts that are set up for some other worthy purpose, and you take the money from it, and it covers up the cash shortfall, but you still, long-term, have a hole in the
budget.
Well,
they just raided the Battery Park City Authority of $400 million. They swept it out.
Yeah, for the city and for the state. And then there are, you know, we found billions of dollars over that time frame of special revenue accounts. The Environmental Protection Fund, as an example. You know, money accumulates. There's money dedicated to that account. and money is then allocated for programs, but it takes a while for that money to be spent. So when excess money is sitting there and there's a shortfall, you say, oh, I'm going to borrow money from that account. The money never seems to get paid back. And in the short run, you think you've plugged a budget hole, but you still have that gap there. And then you keep robbing Peter to pay Paul without confronting the fact that we really just need to not spend as much money as we've been spending on some of these programs.
What else? What else is systemically wrong? I mean, you've been crazed about borrowing.
Yeah. Well, borrowing has been a big issue because what you end up doing is paying for old bills. And in New York, our history has been too often to use borrowing for what should be pay-as-you-go purposes. Debt service is one of the fastest-growing parts of our state budget. So when you're paying debt service, you're using today's dollars to pay for old bills, and again, you don't have the money to spend on the programs that you should be spending it on. So I think there needs to be a realistic cap on debt. We have a debt cap that's porous. The definition
doesn't
hold.
Wait a second. You guys in 2000, to great fanfare, the assembly this Debt Reform Act that was going to solve this problem.
And it has not.
Excuse me.
Yeah, it has not. It has not. And that's why we have to acknowledge that effort did not work, and we need to have a debt cap that is going to be a hard cap. And be sure that we are now going to spend money on what should be long-term investments. Look at our infrastructure needs. We have billions of dollars of infrastructure needs all across the state not being met. We had that bridge failure up over Lake Champlain.
Right.
Now they have to tear the bridge down. They're going to have to put a new one there. We knew that bridge was deficient, yet we didn't have the money allocated to invest that. Not all borrowing, not all debt is bad. But just like you would go into debt for a home mortgage or a major repair, you know, that's what we should be doing with state dollars. Don't borrow money to cover operating deficits. That's been too much of the problem of the
past.
And
they're still doing it. That's what led to the fiscal crisis in New York City in the 70s, and the state's been doing it for decades.
Well, and that's one of the concerns, you know, with the current proposal from Lieutenant Governor Ravitch, who's terrific and brings tremendous credibility to his program. But my concern with what he's laid out is that a big piece of that is borrowing again. So to take some of these, the gap and do in effect the deficit borrowing, and that's just repeating the mistakes of the past, and it puts off tough choices on spending priorities.
But if you look at the Ravitch plan and its entire context, if indeed the legislature bought into, for example, accepting generally accepted accounting principles, put in hard caps,
change the fiscal year,
build
up reserves. So he had a lot of good points in there. Yeah.
But what's going to happen is you've been there. So what's going to happen is they're going to borrow money and do none of the reforms.
Yeah. Although, you know, I've spoken to Lieutenant Governor and he's made clear that he's not going to stand for that. So to the extent that he certainly is the person with credibility, he created the plan. If they're going to gut his reforms and just do the borrowing, he's going to stand up and say, you can't do that.
And he says it's a big deal.
Well, but he's got an important position in that. He's got an important position. And there are we have other proposals as part of reforming debt. One of the big changes in New York's history, you remember the old days, you'd go to the ballot and the voters would approve a debt issuance.
Well,
now only 6% of our debt burden comes from that voter approved debt. We would go back to having voter approved general obligation as the norm rather than the exception.
Okay, wait a second. Where's the other 94% in authorities?
The authorities, the backdoor borrowing through the public authorities that have very little accountability. You know, we just did a major public authorities reform bill in 2009. That's going to help in terms of contract review, but debt is still a big issue where
and
the authorities do this back
doesn't
to borrow.
Deal with that.
No, it does not. So this is very much an unfinished agenda, and that's why that debt reform piece is part of what I strongly recommend. Another change I think would make sense, Doug, is that we've got men and women who are elected to represent their communities in the legislature, in the Senate, in the Assembly, and they're by and large cut out of the budget process. There was a move a few years ago to have conference committees where rank and file members, both sides, majority, minority, Senate, Assembly, be around a table, be involved in negotiating the details of a budget, do it in a public forum so the TV cameras could be there, they could be reporting so the general public could know what some of the options are. We've moved away from that. We've moved back towards 3 or 5 men in a room, however many numbers.
It was inconvenient for leadership who exercised power.
We need to not just have them create these conference committees on paper, but have them meet. You know, there are a lot of smart people in the legislature. I know know, there've been a lot of problems there, but there are also a lot of smart people. If they were engaged in the process, it would make a positive difference.
But why don't they make themselves engaged in the process? I mean, you've got these good folks, but I mean, between the whores, the hucksters, you know, and everybody else, you've got the hapless, and there are a lot of well-meaning, very smart, hapless people.
Yeah.
No?
Yeah. Well, but that's why through a process involving them directly in the budget negotiations, we'll get a better result, and you will reinforce the good people that are there that are trying to
Wait
do the
second.
Right thing.
Yeah, but that's Pollyanna. The leadership is not going to allow it.
You know,
the
whole premise of democracy is Pollyanna, so we can't give up.
I'm sorry, you know, I accused you of being Pollyanna.
That's okay. I've been accused of worse. I'll take that.
And I'm going to accuse you of that right now of worse. Okay, so you lay out really a very detailed analysis of the budgetary games, the shenanigans. Now, your opponent has, in a sense, said, excuse me, you were in the assembly. You were there for 20 years. If I'm them, I'm doing my Oppo research, and every one of your points, I have at least two Tom DiNapoli votes. How do you respond to that?
A couple of things. First of all, it's always interesting when the Republicans accuse you of things. Most of the years I was in the assembly, we had a Republican governor and a Republican conservative Senate. So the budget process at the end, a lot of compromises in it, the majorities have to pass on it. So the Republicans to now accuse me when it was two-thirds their decisions
on this. So this is bipartisan?
It's bipartisan. And the reality is it's gotten a lot worse. And I haven't been in the legislature for 4 years. If my opponent wanted to run against me for assembly, he missed the opportunity a few years ago. And that's always the concern when someone, you know, comes without any record, without ever doing public service. It's very easy to, you know, to throw stones. I'm very proud of the fact that I've chosen to say I want to make a difference in state government, and very proud of my work in the assembly. And now as controller, which is a different perch. I mean, when you're in the legislature, you're representing a constituency, and people evaluate you on how you're representing their priorities. As controller, your responsibility is to look at the long-term trends and point out the problems. The reality is some of the gimmicks are not new, but the acceleration of their use over the past 4 years has been dramatic. And what might have been tolerable if it was done in small doses years ago, or quite frankly, Doug, some of the gimmicks happened after 9/11. You know, we had the dot-com bubble burst and that terrible tragedy in 9/11.
Yep.
We were
in
an emergency situation.
Yep.
We did a lot of things that we perhaps would not have done had we not had that kind of emergency. The problem is we didn't learn from that. So as an example, we had reserve accounts that were created. After 9/11, we tapped into those reserves. When we came back like gangbusters a few years later, Wall Street overheated, a lot of profits, we made the mistake we didn't build those reserves back up again. That's an example of a lesson on the state level that, you know, when you look at the city budget, actually they were much smarter. In those good years of 03, 04, 05, 06, 07, the city paid down some of its debt early. They created a trust fund to deal with retiree health benefits.
Right.
That, you know, they built up their reserves again. It's one reason why the mayor and the city council have been able to weather this tough recession in a stronger condition than the state.
In part, though, it's because the mayor dominates the council in the way that the governor doesn't dominate the legislature. I mean, the legislature is a co-equal branch of government, and they've got their own imperatives. I mean, you were a member. I mean, the imperative for you is to use as much money locally as you can possibly get, essentially.
That's certainly a piece of it. People do look at, you know, what are the institutions in your own community and how are they benefiting or not from the state budget. There's no doubt about it. And at the state level as opposed to the city, you have two houses. And up until very recently, you had split, you know, Republican-Democrat.
Sure.
So that
sure.
that created, you know, this kind of attitude of, well, this is what we need, this is what we need, so we put it all together,
right?
And it just kept creating, you know, growing expenditures. And that's really, I think, one of the issues that we've made decisions, and certainly the legislative process encourages it. I think your point is absolutely valid, to look very short term. What is it that we're getting in this budget or in this session that I can go home and tell everybody about?
Right.
As opposed to, all right, if we agree to this spending program today, which doesn't get implemented until 3/4 of the way into the fiscal year, so it really doesn't cost the full tab until next year.
Right.
You know, that's how you get into this accumulation of programs and spending. And so the problem is we had a number of years where Wall Street was producing profits that benefited New York State way outsized to what any sensible reality of what was sustainable would be. And so even though there was a structural gap, it always seemed to take care of itself. So you fast forward to the, you know, to the Great Recession and 08 and 09, and suddenly, we, you know, Wall Street is not only not giving us outsized profits, they're in the negative. And the recession is hitting us hard a little later than other states, but it has hit New York, hit it hard. We don't have the money anymore. So what's laid bare is this is the structural gap that we haven't addressed and spending commitments that are not sustainable. It's something I said in 07 with the very first budget that was produced by then Governor Spitzer in the legislature, my first year as controller, before we had the collapse. We, you just looked at the out-year trends, it just wasn't sustainable. And that's caught up to us now.
Things didn't change in day one.
They changed, but in some ways they didn't change for the better. I mean, that was really, you know, there was a great expectation that there that the beginning of that tenure was going to be very different. And obviously, when Spitzer came in, he had some great ideas, and it obviously got sidetracked, in a horrible way to witness. And in some ways, you know, we're still trying to get our footing back from that.
Okay, the state's broke, and as you point out, only budgetary sleight of hand didn't make it official, shifting expenditures literally from the last week in March to the first week in April. So we ended up with money in the bank, I don't know, $2.3 billion or something, because of what you call this last minute payment delays and budget manipulations. Is this gonna change? I mean, we've already got a late budget. Is this year gonna be different than any other year? I mean, sort of the Seder question.
Right, yeah. Well, certainly not starting out that way. You know, the fact that the budget's late and the fact that at least while we're doing the show, the parties seem to be pretty far apart on how to negotiate it. But, you know, I think that when I talk to legislators, what I tell them is what I hear when I go around the state. New York families, whether it's here in the boroughs, out on Long Island where I live, upstate, they've been tightening their belts and making tough choices about spending in the face of this great recession that we're still feeling the effects of. They understand government has to do the same. What we need is a process in place that's thoughtful, that's intelligent, that's inclusive, and that's what's been lacking. And that's where I really do believe in an election year where people have been so fed up with what they've been hearing about going on in Albany, now is the time to do things in a different way, and people will understand it and accept it and herald it.
Except when you cut the people's programs, you cut their state aid for schools or hospitals, they don't want it. So the politician or the elected official who sort of, in a sense, tells the truth, you get punished.
That sometimes is the case. But on the other hand, again, to reinforce the point that people are getting it. You know, I just saw in the paper, two school districts on Long Island, the teachers agreed to wage freezes. I think there's always a lag in terms of the reality catching up with practice. I think we're at that point now where the practice has to catch up to the reality.
And so
I
you
think
really
people understand
you seem to indicate that we really have hit a wall, and there is a potential for change.
Yes,
here?
Yes, I, you know, look. If I wasn't an optimist, I wouldn't stay in government. Believe me, I'd be doing something else. And let's keep in mind, it's not just the current pressure of the revenue weakness from the recession. We've been depending this past budget year on the federal stimulus money, on the tax increases that are temporary. That's going to start to disappear. It's going to start to disappear in another year or so. So that revenue cliff is there again. That's why when you look at the out-year projections that we have and Division of Budget has, we still have the
so
problem.
So we need these structural changes.
It has to be a structural change.
Okay, talk about some of these structural changes that you're advocating.
Well, certainly, as our deficit shuffle report points out, we have to get away from using the one-shots as a way to say you're balancing a budget. If you have a one-time source of revenue, you know, pay down some debt, use it for what would be a legitimate one-time expense, but don't use it to cover up what a gap is. I mentioned before in empowering people directly in rank and file legislators in the process. Control debt, which we also covered. It's going to be slow for us to do, but as the Ravage Plan calls, start to build up our reserves so that when we do have shortfalls, we have that rainy day fund put aside, which would be a legitimate fund to dip into for structural balance as you go through that. Be more clear about our revenue forecasting. What happens is when they come up with a revenue number at the beginning of the budget process, it doesn't include all the resources. Well, it actually has to be a consensus of the governor and the Senate and the Assembly. If they fail, it's up to the controller to pick a number. That hasn't happened. But
they don't want you to figure this out.
Well, that's why they always come up with it. But part of the problem is they look at tax rules. They don't look at all revenue sources. So that's where, when you get into the budget, they start saying, we'll have other revenue sources, so we'll make more spending commitments. A more realistic assessment on what all the revenues are and do it with a hard number. That was the problem with the current year's budget. It was based on revenue numbers that were just way too rosy, and anybody that looked at it, objectively, could have said that. So we need a stronger revenue forecasting process in there.
Are we going to have a budget before January 1st, 2011?
Well,
wait for a new?
Yeah, we will? Yeah.
And what is it going to look
like? Do you think anybody in the legislature can run for office in November?
Wait a second, you could do temporaries every week.
In the old days, as we were saying before we went on air, they would do a budget in April. But they do a lot of the nuts and bolts of the supplemental budget in October.
That's going to happen.
I'm not so sure that's going to happen.
Well, you have an election in November.
I think the election and everybody looking will create a different dynamic. Look, it's not going to be a pretty picture because they're going to, under any plan that's out there, they're going to have to do some significant cuts. And some, there's going to be some pain attached to that. The biggest expenses in New York are healthcare and education.
Right.
So when you do cuts, say, hey, CUNY doesn't want to see any cuts. SUNY doesn't want to see any cuts.
Right.
No one does. No one does. I don't do the policy choices anymore.
Okay.
But it's not going to be pretty. But again, I think people understand that if we can right the ship now, as the economy starts to pick up, and it will eventually, everything goes in cycles, there's going to be a slow recovery, but it's going to happen, and we're starting to see some signs, then at least we won't have this albatross around our neck of a state that's broke and can't strategically spend money in ways that are going to support the growth of the economy. We need to not just be talking about cutting, we also need to make strategic investments in certain areas in terms of growing our economy, something we're trying to do with our pension fund investments. It's not just about cutting, but you need the dollars to be able to be strategic, and right now we're just fighting over how to pay for old bills, and that we have to break out of that.
Just being the cynic, I am visualizing right now the air war that will go on when you make significant cuts in education, healthcare.
Some of that now.
It's going to get worse, and it's going to, the drumbeat's going to be, they're going to be tens of millions of dollars that we're killing, not only grandma, but we're killing grandchild. And
but part of it too is, don't forget something like healthcare, which has obviously been a big issue in our nation. Not all those dollars have been spent in the smartest ways. We do audits, another part of our responsibility.
Sure.
We've found waste in the Medicaid program, inefficiency. And if you talk to those in the healthcare industry, at the hospitals, the providers, they have some ideas on how we could spend money in a smarter way that would save money. So some of those ideas that have been out there, gathering dust on the shelf, dust off those ideas and implement them, because there is a way to do some of this, perhaps not all of it, where you actually don't hurt those that need to receive the services. We just need to be a lot smarter. In some of these program areas, we've gotten lazy because we just keep adding money to programs without looking at how that money's being spent.
Let's talk a little bit more about the politics of all this. The governor seems to be absent from, I'm hearing that there's really been no discussion with legislative leaders by the governor, and any discussions have been ravages discussions.
Well, I'm not at the table, but my sense is, from what I hear, there have been discussions. They obviously haven't been as many or as successful as they need to be to get this thing done.
And it's between whom and whom?
Well, at the leadership level, certainly the majority leader, the speaker, the governor. Sometimes they're formal meetings. Sometimes they maybe one conversation. Ravitch is involved in some. Absolutely.
I mean, what's your sense of the relationship? I can't figure it out between the governor and Ravitch. Sometimes the governor's in favor of what Ravitch is doing. Sometimes he's not.
Well,
I don't get it.
Look, there's no doubt it's an awkward situation. You have the governor is there. He's not running again. So in our system, for better or for worse, when you say you're not running, you're deemed a lame duck.
Right.
Limits what you can do. Ravitch is his person, but Ravitch is also an independent
And you've
person
called
as well.
For Ravitch to conduct the budget negotiations.
Well, Ravitch, I feel, doesn't have some of the distractions the governor's had. But in fairness, the governor is engaged in the process. And let's keep in mind, Doug, as you know in observing the scene, a lot of work is done at the staff level. Certainly the staffs have been meeting and talking between the governor's staff and Division of Budget and the Senate and the Assembly. The problem is you need the elected leadership to weigh in to break the logjam that often develops at a staff level. And that's what, with the holidays coming to an end and everybody going back to town, we need that to happen and happen as quickly as possible.
Okay, here we are in the, you know, early April. We don't have a budget. When do you, what has to happen to have a budget? What will this budget look like? We've already talked about it's going to be changed in October.
And well, you know, one of the problems is that if they keep doing emergency appropriations, it'll basically be a bare bones kind of funding. So the state government is still functioning because they did a emergency appropriation that goes to the middle of April. If they keep just doing that, you'll start to see an impact on services. Already, you saw the governor's delaying a school aid payment.
Right.
Some of the construction projects that are very important, you know, that have been in the works, and some of them are even literally in the works, are being held up now as part of the governor's directive. People will start to feel the pinch if this drags out.
Now, is this smart policy or is this smart politics that, you know, you make it hurt and you make it obvious so you're successful? The governor, I mean, or
well, I think
what
I think
are the politics and policy implications?
Well, it's,
of this?
It's certainly the reality. I mean, if you don't have a budget in place, you can't be spending all kinds of money that you really don't have the authorization to do, and it would make no sense to do as sometimes they do in Washington, these continuing resolutions.
Right.
That we shouldn't do. I mean, there's a lot to criticize about Albany. We didn't invent some of the bad practices, and you look at a state like California.
Yeah, but you mastered some of them.
We're New York.
Come on.
You expect
if
us
you can
to
make
do,
it, yeah, right?
Right? Exactly.
Okay.
So, but no, people are going to start to feel the pinch of that. And, you know, frankly, you head towards the end of May, beginning of June, you have big payments.
Yep.
You run out of money.
Yep.
So you have to have a budget in place. You have to. They can't avoid that painful truth. You have to have a budget in place.
So we will have a budget, and we will.
I can't give you the exact.
We've gone into August.
And that was no way to do business. But
okay.
But those were times where also we were more flush with money.
Okay.
Where the debate was over how much to spend, and if we hold out a little longer, we can get more money.
Okay.
We don't have that.
These aren't flush times. This has been the first of a two-part conversation with New York State Comptroller Thomas DiNapoli. Comptroller DiNapoli and I will continue to talk about New York State's and New York City's fiscal life. Please join us again next week. Hello, I'm Doug Musio. Let us know what you think about this show. You can reach us at cuny.tv. When you get there, click on the bar that says Contact Us and send your email. Whatever it is, thanks, no thanks, obnoxious, do it. Send it.